let's start with drawing some walls and talking about their properties. Well, before that, let's add a third level. And I want to change the name to roof. So add the level and just rename it to roof. You don't need to do that, actually. Okay, so when drawing a wall, well, you know that we have control over location line and the height of the wall from options bar, and you can select the type from here, from the type selector. Now, let's draw this wall. I'm going to use brick on CMU. So now let's draw this wall and see what other things we have control over when selecting the wall. It's important to know that whenever we are drawing a wall in a level, the bottom of the wall is connected to that specific level, in this case, level one. Okay, so for example, since I drew my walls in the level one, if I go to an elevation view, you can see that the bottom of the wall is attached to level one. And if I drag this level and move it, then the bottom will move with it. So now, why is that? And how we can control this? Well, let's go to level one again and select the wall so we can see what we have in the properties palette. So every wall you create in Revit has two parameters that are very important. One is the base constraint and the other one is the top constraint. Now, what are these and why we call them constraints? Actually, these wall constraints are one of the things that make Revit a parametric modeler. So by setting these two constraints for a wall, your wall will be kind of locked to the levels you set here. So for example, here, you can lock the base of the wall or the bottom of the wall to level one, as it is here, and the top constraint to level two or roof. I'm going to use roof right now. You could see that since I drew my wall on level one, the base constraint was actually automatically set to level one. So I just needed to set the top constraint. Now, if I switch to elevation view and move the roof level, you can see the top wall will move with it. And we can enter the value here. And this is the same for the base constraint as well. One thing here is that base constraint is not optional and it has to be connected to a level. But the top constraint is kind of optional and you may or may not connect it to a level. Although it's better to always have it attached, there might be some situations you don't want to do that intentionally. But if your wall isn't connected from the top, you need to set a height for it from here. Okay, so select your wall, and if it is unconnected, you need to set a height from here. Okay, so you can set, for example, just 9 feet. And it is just detached from the roof level. Now let's connect it to roof again. We have two other parameters, which are base and top offset. When your wall is attached to a level, you have the option to set an offset amount for the wall. And the reference for the offset amount is the level that the wall is attached to. Okay, you can set the offset amount from properties palette. We have actually the base offset and the top offset. For example, in previous chapters, if you remember, you had to set a 2 feet parapet, and for this purpose, you could set a top offset amount for the wall. Now, let me add these 2 feet and see what happens in elevation when we do this. Okay, you can see the change, yes? So this is our 2 feet offset from the roof level. Now, if you move our roof level, you can see that this is changing too. So the offset is moving with it. Actually, the top of the wall is still attached to it, but you still have this 2 feet offset over here. Now, let me explain these two constraint and offset concepts with the help of a figure in the book. You can find it on page 6-2. So we start from left to right. Actually, in this picture, the walls are all constrained to level one and two from bottom and top, except the first wall, okay? So the first wall, the base constraint is set to level one, but the top constraint is unconnected, and the height is set to 6 feet 6 inches. In this case, whatever change we made to the level heights, this wall will stay 6 feet 6 inches. For the second wall, The base constraint is set to level 1 and the top constraint is set to level 2 and there is no offset. The next one, this one, the base constraint is set to level 1 and the top constraint is set to level 2 and but we have a negative top offset as you can see here. For the middle wall, actually bottom and top are constrained to level 1 and 2 and we have top negative offset and bottom positive offset. And for the rest, again, top and bottom are constrained, and we have either negative or positive offsets from either top or bottom. Now, let's see what happens if we change the level 2 height from 8 feet to 5 feet in this picture. As you can see, all the top walls have adjusted, except the first one, which is unconnected. And this shows that parametric feature that Revit has. So now let's get back to our model. Now, I want to tell you something about properties in Revit. Actually, in Revit, we have two types of properties. Let me select the wall first. Okay, so we have instance properties that you can find them here, and we have also type properties that can be find here in edit type. Now, what is the difference between these two? Well, instance properties has to do with one object or element and can vary by instance, while type properties has to do with a specific type and is the same for every instance of a specific type. Now, I want to show you something that helps you to understand this better. I'm going to go to level 1, and I'm going to insert 4 windows of the same type. For example, 36 by 48. So the very important thing here that I want you to pay attention to and take note is that every time you want to edit type properties of a default element or object in Revit, you need to first make a duplicate of that, okay? Then you can rename it so you know it's a duplicate, not the actual one each time you get back to it. And then you can edit it. This is very, very important. Be careful with this because we don't want to change the default settings in Revit. And the same applies to materials as well, like we had before. Now, because I'm going to change the type properties of this window later on, I need to make a duplicate of that and then insert the window. So let me duplicate and then just rename it to duplicate or copy duplicate one. And now I'm going to insert 4 windows. 1, 2, 3, 4. These windows are all the same type. Now let's switch to the south elevation view. Now, if I want something, for example, windows height to be changed in all of these, I should go to type properties because I want to change the height of this type of window. And to do that, you don't need to select all. You just need to pick one and go to edit type. And then from here, you can change the height, for example, to 6 feet. Now, you can see that they all have changed. Now, what if I wanted to change the sill height of the first one only? So in this case, I should refer to instance properties. And here, I can change the sill height to, for example, 5 feet. And then hit apply. As you can see here, only the first window has changed. And as you can see here, instance properties are usually more limited than type properties. So, for example, I cannot change the height of this window from here, and it can only be changed from type properties.